God has risen, I believe, from our prison where we lived. He's our Savior, dear and true, life eternal for me and you.
I want to acknowledge Jonetta for all the work she does with our videography. She does an awesome job. And, you know, all of these speakers and the whole luncheon will be on video on our website, so you can go there and see. I missed last month, and thanks to Pat, we had a great veterans session last month, and I can't wait to see that. Really, really good. And they're sitting in for David Fry. I want to thank Fry's back here at Cafe. The food is always great here, and really appreciate what they're doing. Okay, I want to introduce Clayton. First of all, this guy does a great job of picking schools. I mean, yeah, he went to Rose Hill, graduated 2011, and Sherry's here to welcome him back. So, any whoops in the audience? Texas A&M in 2015. Get some whoops here. I know we're going to get a few. So after graduation, he went to work at Bill Cody Ranch in Cody, Wyoming, as a wrangler, leading bushwhack trips into the mountains of northwest Wyoming and the wild hills of the country of Montana. Then he had a couple of months as a high altitude camp grizzly bear garden wrangler for hunting. Kind of stuff we all know. Nothing unusual about that. Right? And he's going to share with us how God has led him through. Through and protected them through near death, close calls, freezing, snowy weather, forest fires on the mountains. Yeah. Currently, he's a licensed realtor selling farm and ranch properties. Lives here in Tomball. Has been a part of Tomball Bible Church for many years. And he's a huge Astros fan. Go Astros. Next year. So it's my pleasure to give you Clayton Bice.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Well, I'm excited to be here this morning, or whatever time it is, 12:30. So funny story, before I get started, so Lori, I've never met her before. She calls me about 3 months ago. She goes, hey, I just got off the phone with your dad was in my office about today. He told me a little bit about your story and what you did. And she's like, we have this luncheon that we do about once a month. Would you want to be our guest speaker? And when she called me, I was at a restaurant, and I had a hard time hearing her, and all I said was, sure, why not? And so the next day, I get a phone call from my uncle. You have to know my uncle to appreciate the story. Thinks he's really funny. So he calls me, and he goes, hey, I heard you're speaking at this event. He's like, I'm super happy for you. And I was like, yeah, you know, thanks. He goes, you know it's going to be about 300 people, right? And in my mind, I was just like, yeah, whatever. And he's like, no, I'm serious. It's going to be about 300 people. And I don't know what it was. This is how my brain works. But I said, 25 years old, haven't had the chicken pox yet. December 12th would be a great time to have it. I don't know why it popped in my head, but... So anyway, one of my pet peeves, I guess, or you'd say, I hate public speaking because it's a whole, someone right here, 2 or 3 people, I can do it all day because you got 6 eyeballs. But when you got 90 eyeballs, it's a little bit different. But anyway, there's 2 things that I kind of want to share with you before I get into my story. The first thing is taking a leap of faith and going out of your comfort zone to make yourself a better person. And to do that, what does that take? To going out of your comfort zone. It's making mistakes. In my opinion, making mistakes is going to make you a better person. There's tons of people that I've talked to in the past. They've shared their story, and they've told me all these things that they did. You know, growing up, they were on drugs or whatever. But you could tell they were a better person because of those mistakes. So taking that leap of faith, trusting in God that whatever he has in store for you, it's going to be okay. And the second thing is to invest in someone, to invest in people. There's people in this room, there's people out of this room that need maybe 5 minutes of your time. Maybe they're struggling with something. Maybe they're trying to figure out what they want to do with your life. But you never know that you might go talk to that person, and that person might hop in their truck and go to Wyoming and have the best time of their life. So anyway, just remember those two things, and hopefully I'll try to wrap that in towards the end again. But so I lived in Tomball my whole life. I went to Rose Hill Christian School, graduated in 11. And, you know, growing up, my identity, and I'm sure you can relate to this because you've known me for a long time, I was like the class clown, the goofball. Because that was what I was comfortable with. I was comfortable with that mindset, because I was too afraid to maybe kind of to go out of my comfort zone, out of that, to be maybe, you know, do better in the class or whatever, because I was comfortable with who I was. So I never really challenged myself. So I, by the grace of God, I graduated in 11, and then I went here. It's kind of funny, I'm speaking here. I went to Lone Star for 2.5 years, and I did pretty well there. That was a really good transition for me. And then eventually I got into A&M, and by the grace of God and the help of my mother, I graduated in 15. But before I graduated college, it was probably about October of 2015, and I was really struggling on what to do, what I wanted to do with my life. Because I knew that if I didn't make maybe a change or a mindset, that I was probably going to go and work in Houston, you know, like most people. And there's nothing wrong with that. Tons of people do it all the time. But I felt like there was something more out there, but I didn't know what it was or why God wanted me to do this. But I didn't know what it was. And so I'm in October, I'm at this, one of my good buddies, he's getting married, and so we're at this wedding reception, and I'm just kind of by myself. I'm not talking very much. I'm just kind of, not depressed, but just kind of stressed out, trying to figure out what I wanted to do with my life, because I knew I was fixing to graduate. And so I'm sitting there, and a good family friend of ours comes up to me, and I hadn't seen him in a long time, and he asked me what I was going to do, and I told him, I'm going to graduate here in a couple months. I'm probably going to go get a job in Tomball or in Houston. And before I could finish, he was like, man, he goes, scratch that. He goes, you need to do something different. You need to go do, he told me, you need to go work maybe at a ranch somewhere. He told me about his story that he worked at a ranch in Colorado back in the 80s, I think. And, just telling me, don't go get a job yet. And it was funny because I was sitting there when he was telling me this. I'm like, man, if my dad heard you right now, he'd kill you. Spending all this money and then go work on a ranch or something. So he told me, he goes, man, just think about it. He goes, look at this ranch that I told you about. And he goes, and the second thing is, I want you to go watch this movie called Unbranded. Has anybody seen that movie? Nobody. Okay, so anyway, it's on Netflix. And it's a documentary in 2012 about four guys from Texas A&M that took, let's say, 15 Mustangs from Mexico to Canada in 150 days. I highly recommend watching it. It's very, very good. So anyway, he tells me about it, and I get home that night, and I watch Unbranded. And then I watch it again. And then I watch it a third time. And in my mind, it clicked. It was like, this is what I wanted to do. Because it's growing up, I was a big, and I still am, I was a big John Wayne fan, okay? He's my hero. I can tell you every movie, every Western movie he's made. And I remember as a kid, sitting there, I wish I could do that, ride horses in the mountains. And growing up, I really didn't have that much experience with them. But that's kind of what I wanted to do. And so when I saw that movie, I was like, man, I got to do this. So I started searching around jobs and stuff. And, I kind of forgot that, I got so fired up about doing this. I kind of forgot that I didn't have much horse experience. I kind of forgot about this. So anyway, I find out about this ranch in Cody, Wyoming. And I got a phone number of the owner. And so I called him, and I'm super excited. And the phone's ringing, And then it hit me. I'm like, I'm fixing to talk to this guy, asking him for a job, and I'm going to have to tell him I don't have much horse experience. And all of a sudden, he picks up the phone. And, you know, in my mind, I thought he lived in Wyoming, but he didn't. And he lives in Texas, but when he was talking, he had this real thick East Texas accent. And I said, Ronnie, you know, my name's Clayton Bice. You know, I just graduated from A&M. This was probably January of 16. You know, I heard about your ranch. I feel like this is something that I want to do, but I'm just going to be honest with you. I don't have much horse experience. And it was an awkward pause. And I was like, great, here we go, rejection hotline. And he started laughing. I was like, man, I got kind of defensive a little bit. And I was like, why is this guy laughing? And he told me, he was like, man, he goes, I've talked to you on the phone for 2 minutes. He goes, I already like you. I said, what are you talking about? He goes, most people that call me say they got all this horse experience and stuff, and they get there and they don't know nothing. And he goes, I'm just going to go on a limb on this. He goes, you're hired. I said, really? He goes, yeah. He goes, pack your bags. You're coming in May. So during that time, during the springtime, I had a couple months to kill. So I got my real estate license. So, you know, he told me he's going to be there around April. So I get there, and he told me he was going to be there on a certain day. Well, like most people from East Texas, they're late. Okay, I figured that out real fast. And I get there, and, you know, I'm stuck in this hotel by myself for 3 days. He's 3 days late. And he finally calls me and says, you know, I'll be there tomorrow. So he calls me that day, and he goes, hey, I'm in town. Let's go eat. So in my mind, I'm thinking, okay, I don't know what this guy looks like. Go into this restaurant. Look for the guy that's wearing a cowboy hat, maybe, you know, cinch jeans, a shirt, you know, maybe some spurs, you know, belt buckle, you know. So I go into the restaurant, and I'm looking for that, you know, that guy. And I look over, and this guy's looking at me. And I was like, that can't be him. His name was Ronnie. Ronnie was wearing a Hawaiian t-shirt, an Under Armour hat, Ray-Bans, shorts, and flip-flops. In the back of my mind, I'm like, what did I get myself into? And so we started talking, and we ate dinner, and then we were going to go back to the ranch. And at that time, I was still kind of stressed out because I didn't know what I was getting myself into. Well, it kind of clicked in my head when we started driving down from Cody to the ranch, which is the same highway, the North Fork Highway, which is will take you to the east entrance of Yellowstone. It clicked in my head because I remember going down that road, and I have never seen anything like that before. Because, you know, growing up, I just didn't travel much. I've been on a plane once. I didn't go past Colorado. We went there a couple times. And we're driving down this road, and it was just awesome. I remember it just in my head perfectly. You know, there was 300 mule deer on the left. There was elk crossing the road. There was snow in the mountains. It was just perfect. And in my mind, I was like, this is what it's about. I'm going to have the best time of my life. And it was just like a relief because I felt like this is something that I needed. I needed to see this. So we get there at the ranch, and we're kind of helping set up and stuff. Well, basically what it is, there's a difference between a guest ranch and a dude ranch. A dude ranch, you get there on a Monday. You don't leave till a Saturday. Monday, you're doing this. Tuesday, you're doing trail rides. Wednesday, you're doing, you know, cattle drives, whatever. A guest ranch is basically all we have is horseback rides and cabins. You don't have to stay with us. If you just want to go on a horseback ride, that's fine. But a lot of people would stay with us because we were cheaper than staying in Yellowstone or Cody. And so we started probably, I don't know, April 1st, I think. And that's kind of when it hit me, because for 3 or 4 months that I did that, it was definitely the best experience of my life, because basically I was a wrangler, so basically my job was to take people on horseback rides. And I got to work with people all over the United States, people from, you know, New Jersey, Arkansas, Maine, Florida, California, Utah. and kind of working with those people, they're a little bit different. Because growing up, I had this problem in my head that if you didn't have the same hobbies as me, the same mentality as me, or the same values as me, you were weird. Okay, and my mom would always tell me that it's okay. These people, they're not weird, they're just different. So actually working with these people, these kids, I guess, younger than me, I was one of the older ones, even though their values were a little bit different than mine, or their work ethic or anything, at the end of the day, they were good people. And so to surround myself with people that were different, I learned so much about myself. And then also taking people from, you know, on these horseback rides, again, people from all over the United States and people from all over the world. So I had people from, you know, I took people on from Japan, from Germany, Australia. I mean, you name it, I took them on the road or took them on the ride. And it was kind of funny because doing that for 4 or 5 months, especially people from the United States, when they would come up and they would say, hey, you know, we're here for the 4-hour ride or the 2-hour ride. I got so good about telling them where they were from before they said where they were from. So, you know, especially people from, like, say, Minnesota, their accent that they have, I could tell, hell, I bet you're from Minnesota. And they would just be like, oh, my gosh, how'd you know that? It's just this what happens when you're around people like that. Especially people from Minnesota, where it's very distinctive, in South Carolina. I don't know why. It just is. So, you know, just learning about, you know, taking these people on horseback rides, you know, and just learning, because you're stuck with them for 4 hours, basically. And you're trying to kind of build a relationship with them, and also you're trying to make more tips. That's a lot of it. You know, the more you talk, the better tips they give, because that's how we made our money. So I would talk to them and stuff, and it was so good for me because being around people like that, that are have different cultures, different societies, that's what I needed in my life, was to listen and to kind of change my perspective on things and listen how people, how they live their life and stuff like that. And I did that for about 3 or 4 months, and it was just awesome. I learned so much more about myself and everything else, and learned about, you know, different types of people and where they come from. And I mean, I could go on and tell different stories. But there's one story in particular. I'm going to try to have might have a hard time saying it because it means a lot to me. But anyway, so we were at, not all the time I had rides. Some days I wanted to take a trail ride. And so anyway, Ronnie comes up to me. He goes, hey, he goes, you're not on a ride, are you? And I said, no, sir. He goes, I got a special mission for, or special project for you. And in the back of my mind, I'm just like, I've heard this before. Last time he said that, I was on a roof for 10 hours, you know. So anyway, he goes, hey, I want you to take this girl on a horseback ride. And I said, okay. And he goes, you know, she's autistic. I said, okay, that's fine. I understand that. He goes, I want you to take her on a private ride with just you and her. I said, okay. He goes, but I'm going to throw a curveball at you. And I said, oh, boy, here we go. He goes, she has about 4 seizures a day. It's 1 o'clock, and she hasn't had one yet. My blood pressure's out the roof now. I was fine until he told me that. And, you know, and I don't know what it was, but I kind of had a bad attitude about it. And I'm just going to be honest with you, and I think a lot of it has to do with, you know, what is this girl going to teach me? She's special. Like, what is this ride going to do for me? It's just a waste of my time. And that was my attitude. And I know that's extremely harsh, but I'm just being honest with you. So I'm going on this trail ride and stuff, and she's talking a little bit, and I'm just not saying much. I'm just have a bad attitude. And we're going up this ride and stuff, and I'm just like, why, you know, why did he choose me? And I remember very specifically, I felt like God went to Home Depot, grabbed a 2x4, and just hit me across the face as hard as he could. And I felt like he just grabbed me by the collar and said, what are you doing? He goes, I am trying to teach you something right now, and you're not listening. And from then on now, I mean, that was definitely the best ride because that I ever had, because my heart just opened. And I got to talk with this girl for 3 or 4 hours. And the more my heart opened, the more I understood where she was coming from. That's how she felt normal, was riding, was horse therapy. That's the whole reason why her family took her up to Wyoming, was to do all these horseback rides. And she would do this, you know, she did it, I think, 4 or 5 times a day at different ranches because that was her therapy. That's how she felt normal with society, with the world. And once I started to understand her happiness and that I was a part of that happiness because I was a part of her riding a horse, it just changed my life. It was the best ride I ever had. And you're probably wondering about the seizure. She did have one. Thankfully, only one. And it was kind of funny because towards the end, I was like, man, she hasn't had one yet. You know, it's going to happen. I know it. And, you know, these trail rides, they're no joke. They're not just, you know, flat. Like the one that we were on, it was about, you know, it's about 4 hours. And you're climbing probably about 3,000 feet probably within that 4 hours. And then you start dropping once you get to the top. And there's a couple parts where, you know, it's, you know, you got all the rocks and stuff. And then, okay. And so I was hoping, like, she wouldn't have a seizure right there. And so anyway, we're going down the mountain and stuff, and she, you know, she was talking the whole time, you know, and I was talking back to her, and we were just having a good time. And all of a sudden, you know, she's behind me because I'm in the front, and it goes quiet. And I look back, and she's having one. And thankfully, you know, the horse that she was on was really good, and she was her arms were locked up, and she was pulling the reins on that horse, and that horse was backing up slowly. And I look behind her, and there's a cliff. And that horse keeps going back and back and back. And thankfully, I was smart enough to get off the horse, and I just basically got the reins or the bridle and just ripped it off the horse's head. Now there's no control. And I ripped her off the horse, and, you know, first of all, I didn't know what to do. And the only thing that's kind of stuck in my mind, if someone has a seizure, turn them on their side. And that's what I did. And after about 2 minutes, you know, it kind of went away, and I helped her back on the horse, and it was like nothing happened. I mean, she was just laughing and just, you know, just telling me all these kind of stuff and, you know, stuff like that. And I remember going up the ranch road, and because we were probably about 30 minutes to an hour late. And, you know, I don't have, you know, we don't have walkie-talkies or radios, or my cell phone wasn't working, so I couldn't tell anybody what happened. So we were going up the ranch road, and her mom was sitting there, and as soon as she saw me and her, she just started busting out just crying because she knew that her daughter was safe. And she saw the look on her daughter's face and know that she had a great time. So it was opportunities like that where I got to meet different types of people and going out of my comfort zone and doing stuff like that. It was just an awesome experience for me. And that's what I needed in my life during that time. I needed a challenge. So I did that till probably September 1st, September 2nd. And then I went to hunting camp. So you're probably asking, where's the bears in the story? So hunting camp was totally different from the ranch. Basically what we did was we did elk hunts. I was going to be there probably about 40 days, and I didn't know what I was getting myself into. It's a totally different ball game. I mean, when I say I was roughing it for 40 days, I was roughing it, meaning I didn't take a shower for 2 weeks. Sorry. I mean, that's just the way it was. That's the lifestyle that those people live, especially doing the hunting camp and stuff. And so anyway, so basically, from the kind of give you a perspective on what I did, from the trailhead to camp was 14 miles, and it's what they call wilderness. Okay, wilderness is different from a national forest. Wilderness means you can't have no small engines, no four-wheelers, no dirt bikes, no nothing, which means no chainsaws. So everything had to be on horseback and pack mules and stuff like that. So these 14 miles, I mean, you know, the first 3 or 4 miles, it was pretty flat. And then all of a sudden, you're starting to climb. So from the trailhead to the camp, you're climbing probably about 6,000 feet in elevation. And, you know, I thought some of the trails that we did at the ranch and stuff were bad. Let me tell you, totally different ball game. And there would be parts where you're going down the trail and you're doing switchbacks and you've got a rock wall right here and then you've got a 500 feet drop 2 feet from you. And it's not that big of a deal when you're, like for me, just riding a horse, but it was the pack string behind you that made things very, very complicated because they're tied together. So you definitely had to put your head on a swivel. So we get there to camp and stuff, and it was definitely the hardest work I've ever done in my life. I was 185 pounds. I'm 176 pounds right now. I was a little hefty up there. 185 pounds or whatever, and in 35 days or 40 days, when I came back, I was 159 pounds. So, I mean, because it was typically from 4 in the morning till about 11 at night for 40 straight days. So anyway, it was kind of a good experience at the same time because, you know, the hunters that we had, they were from all over the United States as well. A lot of people from Wisconsin, had people from Tennessee. And so I got to talk with them and to learn, you know, stuff about them and stuff like that. And, you know, hunting camp, I mean, Cody, Wyoming was super pretty, but going to hunting camp, it's so remote. There's no power lines, there's no cabins, nothing. And plus when I got there, you know, you're now at 10,000 feet in elevation. I mean, it's very hard to breathe. So it took me probably 4 or 5 days to stop getting a headache, really. And anyway, so the camp was just awesome because part of my job, I had so many jobs, and that was the reason why I lost so much weight because I just never sat still. You know, typical morning was I would have to help the hunters. I would have to go in their tents while they were asleep and start their stove for them so they could warm up while getting ready. And then I would have to go help cook breakfast. And then before I ate, I had to go saddle the horses. And then I would have to pick the horses out by myself, feed them, do everything, put the saddles on them, and then go back to the dining room tent and eat and stuff, and then go back and help the hunters on the horse and the guides and send them off. And then I had to go clean dishes. And then by that time, it was probably about 9 o'clock. And the night before, because we had about 20 horses probably, and the ones that we weren't going to use that morning, I would let them go. They were landlocked, basically. So they would go in, you know, a couple miles from camp and go eat, drink, whatever, because we didn't have enough food for them. So typically about 10 o'clock when the hunters would go and stuff like that, that's when I would get on my horse and go find these horses. And that's where I saw the bears, you know, because basically you're going a couple miles from camp and stuff like that. And there were certain spots I knew where the horses were. The night before, when we let them go, we would put bells on them so we could hear them. So when they're running, you know, that thing is going off and I can go find them. Well, they would get real, I found out real quick, they would get really smart. When they would hear you coming, they wouldn't move. Because they could be 20 feet from you and you would have no idea. So anyway, that's where I would see the bears and stuff. And, you know, you're like, where's the bear story? Well, one bear story that I have is when I was looking for these horses, I come around this turn and there's 3 cubs right there, probably about 100 yards away. Not a big deal. I've seen it before, but I didn't see the mom. And I look to my left and the cubs are over here and the sow is that way. I'm in the middle. And so my heart rate is just pumping. And so the sow, basically, she was probably about 100 yards away, and she stands up. And I'm in my mind, I'm just like, Lord, please help me. And this bear starts taking off basically towards me. And the horse, I was on a horse when this happened. And thankfully, the horse didn't freak out too much. And then the bear got about 30, 40 yards away and stopped and basically stood up, and they call it bluff charging. And she stood up, and I slowly backed away because in my mind, you know, I wanted to just take off. But all the outfitters that have done that their whole lives said, whatever you do, do not run. They say, stand your ground. And so that's what I did. Even though it was really hard when a bear is coming at you, you know, you're just like, stay still, stay still, stay still. It was tough. But anyway, and then also, the hardest thing about camp was being by myself. Because someone has to stay at camp according to the Forest Service for bears. So someone has to stay at camp so they don't tear up the tent, basically. So that was, your mind plays tricks with you when you're at, you know, when you're in a place like that, knowing that you're by yourself. You know, if something happens, you're done. You know, if you break a leg or whatever. I mean, we had a satellite phone, but if something really happened that was really, you know, emergency, you know, it would take maybe 10 minutes to get a signal. Because you would have to go out camp, you know, put the antenna on and walk around like this. And then eventually, if you're lucky, you'll get a signal. So I knew if something happened that was really bad, I'm done for. So all these things are playing in your head. And that's kind of where where faith comes in, is my prayer life got so good at camp. Let me tell you, it did, because I knew that I didn't have anybody else, and all I had was God. That was it. And so my prayer life, I mean, I had all these conversations with God all the time, like, God, just get me through this. Like, I'll be a great person when I get back. Just stick with me here. And you know, and being at camp by yourself, especially, you know, especially at night, you know, you're by yourself and you're sleeping with one eye open. And, you know, I had bear spray right here, and then I had a shotgun on my lap. And it's funny how the body works. As much, you know, you work in 15, 16 hours a day, I didn't sleep good at night at all, even when I had other people with me. It's just, you know, I was always stressed. So it was just a cool experience, and especially being at camp, you know, by yourself. I got smart enough where I had a couple horses with me. I would surround them by the tent, and they told me that you could do that because, you know, bears typically, if he's going to come in, you know, he's not going to mess with horses. So I did that, and so that the hunting camp was great. That was a great opportunity for me. I mean, there was some just awesome places that I saw. And just some cool country. So anyway, kind of bring back to what I was talking about with the, you know, going out of your comfort zone. You know, what does that mean to you? Okay, going out of your comfort zone, taking that leap of faith. You know, my whole life I've been told that by, you know, teachers, pastors, I mean, you name it. But what did that mean? And for me, I can say today that I've lived that life, taking that leap of faith, taking that challenge. Because what I did, you know, packing up, getting in my truck, going to Wyoming, that wasn't me. I mean, I was that kind of guy that stayed in his little bubble. You know, I never went outside that bubble because I was afraid to make a mistake, because I wasn't comfortable with it. So what does that mean, taking that leap of faith and taking that challenge? That's what I did. And sometimes that's what you need in life, is to do something like that. And you can take that into, you know, perspective of, you know, being a leader at your church, you know, a teacher or whatever. You need examples like that in your life. And I can truly say that what I did and what I experienced has made me a better person. And the second thing that I was going to tell you about was to invest in people. To me, that's what changed my perspective on life, because that guy that came and talked to me when I was at that wedding reception, he didn't have to do that. And when I got back to the ranch, or when I got back to Texas, I called him and said, hey, you know, I don't know if you're aware, but, you know, I was in Wyoming for 7 months. He goes, really? I said, yes, sir. And I said, it's because, I was like, you remember that one time that you came and talked to me? He goes, yeah, I remember that. He goes, you were the reason why I did that, because you put that perspective in my life, or that direction. And I asked him, I was like, I got to ask you one question. I said, why'd you do it? He goes, man, he goes, to be honest with you, he goes, you look like you were struggling. And I started kind of tearing up a little bit. And I said, you know what? I was. And I said, I thank you so much for doing that. Because you changed my direction on life. Because you spent 5 minutes with me. Okay? And that's what I'm just trying to encourage you, because living that life and seeing how someone went out of their way to come talk to me. There's people in this room or people outside that room that might need 5 minutes of your time. Because you never know. It could change their direction on life. You could, you know, talk to them, and they might pack up their bags and go to Wyoming and have the best time of their life. People aren't perfect. I know sometimes we think, oh, I don't need to talk to this person. They got everything going for them. That's not true. I promise you. Kind of to wrap this up a little bit, the hardest day I ever had in my life was hopping in that truck going back to Texas. Because I was kind of thinking, my journey's over. And that was a tough day. And kind of a side note, that same day, I remember it very specifically. When I hopped in my truck, my stuff was packed, I was going back. I patted myself on the back and I said, you did it. You did something that challenged yourself. You went out of your comfort zone and you trusted in God. You took that leap of faith and look what happened. You had the best time of your life. And the coolest thing about this whole story is the few times that I've shared my story, I've had moms come up to me. And they're like, hey, you know, I talked to little Jimmy last night. You know, little Jimmy's struggling. What he wants, he's fixing to graduate college. You know, he doesn't know what he wants to do with his life or with his life. Would you spend 5 minutes with him and talk to him? And in my head, that's when it clicked, realizing that all the experiences that I did, all the people that I met, and how it made me a better person, and now to share my story and maybe to influence someone other. It's a cycle. That's what it is. That's pretty much it. I'm sure I'm missing probably half my story. Is there any questions? Does anybody have? Yeah, we can. Do we have time? I know I went a little late.
Almost heaven, West Virginia. Blue Ridge Mountains, Shenandoah River. Life is old, death older than the trees.
Younger than the mountains, growing like a breeze. Country roads, take me home to the place I belong. West Virginia,
mountain mama. Country roads.
If I
all my memories
should stay,
they gather round her.
I'll
a miner's lady, stranger
way
to the water.
So I'll go
dark and dusty,
yet I know
painted on the sky.
I'll
miss the taste of moonshine,
the
teardrops in my eyes.
Country roads.
Roads on the road again, like a band of gypsies, we go down the highway.
I wish you joy and happiness. But above all this, I wish you love.
And I
sinking in the west, the cattle go down to the stream, the red wing settles in the nest, it's time for a cowboy to dream. Purple light in the canyon, that's where I long to be with my three good companions, just my rifle, pony, and me. Gonna hang my sombrero
on the limb
of a tree.
Coming home,
sweetheart, darling, just my rifle, pony, and me. Just my rifle, my pony, and me.
Whippoorwill in the willow sings a sweet melody. Riding to Amarillo,
just my rifle, pony, and me. No more cow to be roping,
no more stray.
Will I see
round the bend,
my rifle, pony, and me. For my rifle, my pony, and me.
hearing your concerns about my happiness. But all the thought you're giving me is conscience, I guess. If I were walking in your shoes, I wouldn't worry none. Well, you and your friends are worried about me. I'm having lots of fun.
Counting flowers on the wall, that don't bother me at all. Playing solitaire till dawn with the deck of 51. Smoking cigarettes and watching Captain Kangaroo. Now don't tell me I've nothing to do.
Last night I dressed in tails, pretended I was on the tag. As long as I can dream, it's hard to slow the swinger thing. So please don't give a fuck to me, I'm really doing fine. You can always find me here and having quite a time.
Counting flowers on the wall, that don't bother me at all. Playing solitaire till dawn with the deck of 51. Smoking cigarettes and watching Captain Kangaroo. Now don't tell me I've nothing to do.
It's good to see you, I must go. I know I look a fright. Anyway, my eyes are not accustomed to this light. And my shoes are not accustomed to this hard concrete. I must go back to my room and make my day complete.
Counting flowers on the wall, that don't bother me at all. Playing solitaire till dawn with the deck of 51. Smoking cigarettes and watching Captain Kangaroo. Now don't tell me I've nothing to do. Don't tell me I've nothing to do.
He's pounding down, loaded up and trucking. Are we gonna do what they say can be done? We've got a long way to go. A short time to get there. I'm eastbound just like no bandit run. Keep your foot hard on the pedal. Some never mind them brakes. Let it all hang out, cause we got a run to make. The boys are thirsty in Atlanta, and there's beer in Texarkana, and we'll bring it back no matter what it takes. Eastbound and down, loaded up and trucking. Are we gonna do what they say can't be done? We've got a long way to go and a short time to get there. I'm eastbound, just watch old bandit run. They say can't be done. We've got a long way to go and a short time to get there. I'm eastbound, just watch old bandit run. Old Smokey's got them ears on. He's hot on your trail. He ain't gonna rest till you're in jail. So you got to dodge him, you got to duck him. You gotta keep that diesel trucking. Just put that hammer down and give it hell. Eastbound and down, loaded up and trucking. Are we gonna do what they say can't be done? We've got a long way to go and a short time to get there. I'm eastbound, just watch old bandit run.